So,
okay.
I'd just like to introduce Del Case.
Thanks, Fran. Thanks. Well, again, thank you so much to the library and to Megan Allen, the friends of the library, for having me back. I've loved coming and doing these kinds of talks, and I've done some talks on classical music and also on popular music. This is the first time I've done something specifically on a particular artist or recording artist like the Beatles. And so, obviously, it's the 50th anniversary of the Beatles releasing their first song, right, 1962, that 50, right? So it's a great year for Beatles. I should say at the outset that there are probably a lot of people in this room, including people who may or may not be wearing I Love Beatles sweatshirts, who know more about the Beatles than me. You know? Because, I mean, and as I just told one gentleman, I'm not a super fan. I'm a musician, and I'm particularly drawn to the musical structure, and we'll talk about what musical structure is in just a moment. Now it's been my entree to the Beatles. And I learned the music first, and then I found out how important they were historically and culturally, etc. And so I certainly know a fair amount about that kind of stuff, but I got to tell you, there are certainly people here who know the biographies and all the details and probably have read more books than I have, and I want to say that my hat is off to you, because you can study the Beatles for a lifetime and not learn everything. And it's very, very important. I mean, there are folks in academic departments at universities that do focus on the music of the 1960s, even of the Beatles, who write academic works on the Beatles. And at this point, you can study the Beatles as significantly and as intensively as you can study other classical composers. There's a handout that's, well, I'll talk about the handout later. So, let me just tell you that what I'm going to bring today is a discussion of music, but that doesn't mean that because I have a little corner of knowledge that it is, I truly don't think it's more important than the knowledge that some of you may have, and certainly the experience, even personal experience with seeing the Beatles live, or I think there's somebody here even from Liverpool, right? Is that true? Right, okay, so my hat is off to you. I mean, I wish I were you. Maybe at some point we can have you or any of you come to give talks about the Beatles as a cultural phenomenon, as an historical phenomenon, and that is not my specialty. There are very few people that sort of do the kind of thing that I do, so I'm going to sort of be equal time when it comes to that. So that leads me into the first thing I wanted to say, which is, hi, I'm Del Case. Nice to meet you. Caveats aside, and I live here in Quincy. I've lived here since 2004. Teaching at Eastern Nazarene College for a while, and now I'm at Wheaton College, but I couldn't leave Quincy. I also play Sunday mornings at St. Chrysostom's Church on Hancock Street. We only do Beatles in church. It's awesome. That's not true, but it's still awesome. I've done the Quincy Summer Singers, and I've done performances here at the library, and it's really exciting for me to be here in front of many people that I know. So thanks for having me, and thanks to the library again. So there's a handout that eventually is coming around, and I'll just stall until it gets there. No. I wanted to start, before I talk about the music, just sort of frame the discussion we're going to have starting today and then the next two Tuesdays, if you can dare to come back after tonight. That's the test, right? And the first question I have, and you'll see this, is why talk about music? Why talk? I like that. Why not? You know, I mean, what's wonderful about music is that it's different from speech. A song is not just a poem with music. It's its own whole entity. And it requires a way of talking and a way of understanding the world that is very different from that of just literature. Okay? But one of the wonderful things about music is, again, it's not just words. Which is funny for music that has words in it. It's not just words. And a lot of people that write about popular music of any sort oftentimes ignore the music, right? They talk about the lyrics. And if you read a review in Rolling Stone or the Boston Globe or anywhere about a new CD that's released, 99% of the information in there is going to be about either the lyrics or something non-musical, about the live show or the way the band dresses or their biography, right? Yeah. Okay? Which is kind of amazing when the fact is that it's the music sector. They're actually musicians, right? So I'm hoping to rectify that problem. But again, the question is, why talk about it? I mean, if it's not just spoken words, then why should we even talk about it? It's its own thing. Let's enjoy it. And I'm with you. Music can move you in ways that spoken word does not. Not better or worse, but I think different. But there is a space, and there is a reason why we should actually talk about it. And that's because, for good or for ill, spoken language is how we make sense of the world primarily. Okay? And so my job tonight is to take a musical phenomenon which many of you certainly love, and use my training and my vocabulary and sort of interpret what I know about the music of the Beatles in terms that you can understand. And the goal is to increase your appreciation and love for the music of the Beatles, if that's possible, right? It may not be possible. But I think you'll find if you come to tonight's talk and maybe the next two that some of the things you'll learn about how to listen to music, some of the terms you'll learn, these are things you can apply to listening to any kind of music. And my hope, one of my hopes, is that you will return home after these discussions, listen to the music of the Beatles with different kinds of ears, appreciate and love the music more. But then maybe when you go to Symphony Hall next week, hear a couple of these things, which hopefully will increase your love for Beethoven, for example, your appreciation. Essentially, my job is to help sort of teach you a language that you can employ when you come into contact with music. So the broader goal is to help you enjoy and love the music more by equipping you with certain kinds of oral tools or listening skills. So in a sense, this is a music appreciation course using the Beatles. At the same time, my second question is not just why talk about the music, or talk about music at all, but why talk about the Beatles, right? So we're going to flip it around. We are going to focus on the music of the Beatles, and we're going to try to answer that question, what makes it so great? What are some of the musical things that make it wonderful? And I'll tell you a little bit of a story about why the Beatles for me. I think one of my earliest musical memories is sitting for hours at home and building with Legos and listening to my dad's Beatles LPs for hours. And I was scared to death of a lot of the psychedelic music. I'm the Walrus, scared pants off. Right? And then there's that. Remember that album? It's called this freaky, trippy from the film. It's really scary for a 5-year-old, right? And the music is very scary too. We'll get to that music next week, actually, when we talk about psychedelia. But I think one of my most formative musical influences or experiences was listening to all these Beatles albums and then putting together and building these things. And I like to think that maybe that's why I am, when I'm not teaching at Wheaton College, I'm a composer. I create pieces of music out of basic building blocks, right? 12 notes, right? And so maybe the engineering gene that turned me into a composer connected with the musical influence of the Beatles and has really changed my life. So I love that music, but I have a personal experience. I think that the Beatles made me help guide me to a certain career. And so that's exciting for me. And I know probably every one of you in this room has a story that's similar, like where you first heard the Beatles or the first Beatles song you loved. And maybe that's connected with a person in your life that you love or a place or a time period that you want to go back to, even if it was last week. And so that kind of personal connection to the music of the Beatles, I think, is rare. I don't think there are a lot of popular musicians that have that kind of sort of personal connection. I think that's because the music is so broad and so interesting. But I'm getting ahead of myself, because I just want to, before we actually listen to a song, I want to focus in a little bit and address the question, how are we going to listen, right? How are we going to, if we're going to talk about music and we're going to talk about the Beatles, well, how are we going to do it, right? Well, I'm going to start by talking about what we're not going to talk about. We're not going to talk about the stuff that's not the music. You with me so far? As I said, there's so much stuff. And when we listen to any piece of music, especially popular music, Led Zeppelin, Metallica, who knows, the Beatles, there is so much other stuff. Again, there's the live show. There's the haircuts. That's an important thing when it comes to the Beatles, right? Yeah. There's the accents. There's the way they move on stage. There's the history of the band in England or in America, right? There are layers and layers and layers of important non-musical knowledge that I'm not really going to address, because many people address it much better than me. Journalists, historians, biographers, musicologists, people who focus on things other than the musical structure. But again, what I bring here is a training as a musician who has these tools, and I think a particular skill in interpreting some of the musical aspects for people just like you, for lay people. So we're going to stick to the musical structure. And I use that term a lot, and I want to clarify what that means. Musical structure is akin to, I'll start with an analogy, it's akin to the plot in a novel. Okay? It's an underlying main idea that's not actually present in the book itself. So follow with me here just for a minute. You read a novel. And when you put it down, someone asks you, well, what happened in it? And you say, what happened? Okay, Jason Bourne was a spy. He lost his memory. He ran around Europe. It was awesome. Okay. Now, that never actually happens in the book, right? Because there are things like characterization that get in the way, right? Or any language, word choice, the pacing of the plot, all these things which aren't actually the plot, yet there is a plot. You with me on this, the following so far? Now, it's the same way with a piece of music. It's a little easier to understand in classical music, because in classical music, we have the plot is the musical score. It's the ideas, right? But we never actually access that score. We can only access the music by listening to a performance of the music, right? In which somebody else takes these ideas and manifests them or realizes them for us, right? So plot is the musical score. The novel itself is the manifestation or the performance, right? But fundamentally they're both there, right? We have main ideas that are only present as abstractions, right? The musical score is an abstraction. The realization, the performance, that's the sort of the real thing. Well, let's take a look at a song like "Can't Buy Me Love" by the Beatles. Well, we can talk about how great the Beatles harmonies are, how Ringo chose just the right kind of snare drum for that backbeat, how the recording engineers got just the right kind of mixing. There are so many things in the music that we call surface, right? They are manifestations. They're the parts of the music that are easiest to grab onto, but they're not really the crux of the song. They're not the plot, right? And the plot is the musical structure. It's this abstract set of ideas. It's almost speculative and philosophical in this way. So when we look at music, we talk about like a song like "Can't Buy Me Love." We're going to talk about the chords. The chords are C, F, G. I think I don't remember what key it's in. Okay, but we never get those actual chords played like this in "Can't Buy Me Love." Right? We get the song, and the song can be reduced and abstracted down to its chords. Right? And there's room for appreciating and loving the song that we hear, but there's also room for understanding how this fundamental abstract structure of these chords works to make the song work. Same way with melody. When we hear Paul McCartney sing or John Lennon sing, we can respond to his voice, to the way they sing, the way they sing the melody, but there is an abstraction. There is the melody, which if I said, "Can't buy me love, love," I'm singing the melody, right? I'm not singing John Lennon singing or Paul McCartney singing, right? I'm singing this abstract structure, the melody. Same with, a number of other aspects like rhythm. These are all these things which we can deduce out of the surface, out of the recording, and evaluate and understand as abstractions, okay? I know this is, again, a little philosophical, but that's important because there's a lot that we're not going to talk about. I'm never going to say, look, when Paul McCartney's voice goes up. I'm going to talk about how the melody goes up. This abstract aspect of the music. And if that abstract aspect, if that skeleton is strong, well-proportioned, okay, then any kind of flesh you put on that skeleton is going to be similarly undergirded, okay? It's going to be powerful. That's why these Beatles songs are so great, because almost anybody can do a cover version and it sounds pretty good, you know, because you can recognize the song and, I mean, no, you can screw it up. Believe me, you can screw up. Okay, but I guess what I'm saying is that there's a richness in the music which allows other people to make their own versions and find life inside that structure. So what is that structure? I'm going to get past all of that, all this methodology, as we'd say in the academy, and get right to the structure. And we're going to start with the music. So I want to start by talking about the song "Can't Buy Me Love." And in fact, there's only one more piece of fundamental baseline stuff before we go on. And that is, we're going to look at musical structure, rhythm, harmony, melody, harmonic rhythm, which you may not know about, and you will learn about. Okay? And we're going to filter all those through a fundamental concept about what makes a piece of music great. Because you've got to have to answer that question, right? Lots of things make music great. I'm going to tell you about only one of them. Okay? And it's music as drama. Okay? The filter that I'm going to put up is that many Beatles songs are great because they operate as drama, as narratives. Songs that tell a story, not literally like Eleanor Rigby, but through the music itself. The musical structure has a narrative component. The musical structure has a dramatic component. And if we learn to listen to these two-minute songs as dramas, we can get closer to, I think, what makes them so special and so powerful and rich. Now, in a great drama, let's think of a, just watch all the Bourne Identity movies, so I'm going to stick with Jason Bourne. What makes a great suspense or action thriller? Well, it's something that pulls you along from moment to moment, right? It never lets you go. It could be a page turner, or it could be a film. And how does a piece of art do that? How does a novel or a film or a piece of music do that? Well, it comes down to attention, okay? Keeping you interested and pulling you along. So every moment you're not quite sure whether you're gonna go here or here or here, but every time that detour happens, you're happy you went there. And if you are writing a novel or a narrative poem or writing a piece of music even, if you can keep your listener or your audience with you every step of the way so they don't get bored until the very end, then you got them. Then you have them. And I'm gonna argue that Beatles songs do that. I'm just gonna tell you why. That's what's gonna happen tonight. So we're gonna start that in just a sec. Remember that to stay interested, you have to be not bored, but also not confused. Because the moment there are too many detours, like say you're trying to drive around, let's say, the Ponset Bridge, I never know what lane to get in, right? I get confused, I get angry, right? But if it's also same commute every day, I don't want to. I get bored. I tune out, start checking my phone, I crash, right, et cetera. So just like driving over on the Ponset Bridge or in Quincy, I mean, to be interested, maybe a couple lane changes now and again, but you want to stay on target, but there's just enough variety to keep you interested. Okay, maybe driving's a bad analogy. Okay, don't drive like me. But you can see that if you can do that in a novel, you've got your listener or your reader, right? If you can do that in a film, you've got your viewer, and if you can do that in a symphony, okay, that's good. But you can also do that in a two-minute song. So let's talk about how Can't Buy Me Love does that. What you have right here is essentially the form of Can't Buy Me Love, which is, oh, great, thank you so much. So we've
I don't have enough handouts for everybody. I'm printing more. If you came with somebody, please share. Okay, there's not enough for everybody to have their own.
Great.
And I'll come down in another 15 minutes. We'll
oh, thank you so much, Megan. So I'm going to play this song. We'll give you some time to hand these out. Before I do, I want to show the diagram that I have here. This is essentially the form, the number of sections in Can't Buy Me Love. And these numbers represent the number of measures. So essentially, if you count to four, one, two, three, four, that's one. So if you don't believe me, count one, two, three, four, two, two, three, four, three, two, and you'll get these numbers. Except, this would actually be nine, but we'll talk about that later. So as you follow along, if you do get your sheet of music, count along, and just it will refresh your memory. And then we're going to talk about how a couple of things keep you constantly on your toes in this song and sort of make it into a mini action thriller of a song. Okay? So just pass these out quietly, and we'll listen to this song. All right. Oh, wait a minute. Let me make sure to talk about the right song. Yes, Can't Buy Me Love.
Can't buy me love.
Three, four, one. You want to count at home? Three, four. Okay, it works. Six. Oh, six.
Got it.
That works. My handout's right. God, I think. I don't remember. There it is. All right, verse three, if you're following along. And then this is the bridge, the guitar solo.
No, say you don't need no other things, and I'll be sad.
Anybody not never hear that song before? Okay, just want to make sure it's okay. Got to pass on the knowledge to the new generation. So hopefully you know it reasonably well, but we played it again, and we will play it one more time. And I'm sorry for getting my math wrong, but it's all right on here, except for the 8 bars at the beginning, which is actually important. So thank you for being my test case for these lectures. So how is it possible for what we just heard, 2.5 minutes, to be likened to an action thriller or a suspense novel? Well, I'll tell you. Okay. First of all, the only way that we're going to be able to appreciate that fact is if we learn sort of what lens to use, how to get into this song, right? And the lens I'm going to use here is that of the length of each section. So you notice one thing is that the lengths of each section are actually different. Kind of surprising, but you know what? Most of the time when we sing a song that we know, let's say a folk song, each phrase is 4 bars long, right? Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are, up above the world so high, like a diamond in the sky. And it repeats, okay? So we have 4 bars, 4 bars, 4 bars, etc. And that's pretty it's to be expected. It's sort of baseline. Well, this song does a number of different things. First of all, it starts out by having only 6 bars in the introduction, which is actually significant, and I'm sorry I messed that up on the handout, okay? So immediately, even though you may not know it, it's almost like starting a film with a car chase in which you don't know who's in the car, okay? So an action, like these James Bond films, always start with a great action sequence, right? Usually James Bond is involved, but the fact is that they grab you right away. And that's important, because you're not going to start with James Bond walking on and say, hi, I'm James Bond. Well, thank you for coming to the film. In this film, I'm going to be meeting a Russian guy and a beautiful woman, and then I'm going to... No, you got to start, boom, before the credits even start. In fact, these days, credits are usually at the end of the film. Notice that? They start right away. They're not going to even... The preview happens, boom, you're in. Okay? That's essentially what happens here. The 6 bars sort of says to you, and you don't know this consciously, but it says to you, wait a minute, it's missing 2 bars. Two extra bars. What are these people doing to me? Okay? Then there's a verse. And that verse is a 12-bar verse, and it's called a 12-bar blues, very common chord progression. It's the fundamental chord progression of the blues. Makes sense, the Beatles loved the blues, and their later music had a lot more blues, actually, especially in the later 60s. So we have a 12-bar blues, another 12-bar blues, which is great. And then we have a chorus, which is the Can't Buy Me Love part, right? That's 8 bars. That's what we expect. And I'll walk you through this, don't worry. Okay? Can't buy me love, love. Anybody tell me so? Can't buy me love, love. No, 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 no. It's very square. You can almost expect it, right? And that's great. It's like in the middle of a song or in the middle of a film, in between a bunch of car chases, you know, a love scene or something like that. I was just watching Mission Impossible this afternoon with my 12-year-old, and, you know, he had to fast forward all the kissy parts because she was bored, and they are boring compared to, like, people ripping their faces off. You know what I mean? But it's going to have to happen, and that actually makes sense. So as we listen to this song, we start maybe a little bit off kilter. Then we have these blues. We know, okay, it's a blues, 12 bars. Like, I got it. In fact, it happens twice. 2 times is a pattern, right? They teach you that in first grade. Then this chorus, 8 bars. It's what we expect, but we haven't gotten it yet in this song. It's the love scene. Ah, good, regular old 8 bars. Then we're back. Then we have a bridge, which is the same chord progression as the verse. So now we've got, we're back to 12 bars. Then we've got a chorus again, back to 8. And then the outro, okay? Which is, am I counting it wrong? Yeah, 8 bars. Okay, good, exactly. I'm really good at this. Okay, I can count like you wouldn't believe. So interesting, if you just look at this as just straight up data, the numbers don't really show much of a pattern, do they? 6, 12, 12, 8, you've got the third verse, which is where the extra bar is, dum dum dum, extra bar, which is even more cool. Right before the guitar solo, there's an extra bar, a 13th bar, which, again, just when you think you've settled down into 12-bar blues, he makes you wait. When I say he, I mean whoever endowed this song, the Beatles, etc., wait one extra bar before dropping the guitar solo in. So it actually is even more sort of flummoxing or confusing. Now, I'm not saying that you're counting while you're singing this song, but I would argue that if there was a version of this song in which every phrase was the same, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, you know what? I bet you it wouldn't have been a hit, because that is such a boring structure. It's a part of musical structure that is so predictable that very few songs, successful songs, actually are so predictable. Because very few great pieces of drama are 100% predictable. So I'm going to play that song again, and I'm going to walk you through it. Now count if you'd like. I'm going to try not to screw it up. Follow your sheet here, okay? And maybe you can start to sense that there's just a different length for everything, and it's sort of hard to tell what's going to come next. Now, you all know this song, so you know what's going to come next, and that's one of the reasons why sometimes when you listen to a song, you enjoy it less and less. Have you noticed, has this ever happened to you? You hear a song that you love, and after like 50 listenings, it doesn't do it for you anymore? Now, some songs, it never happens. But one of the reasons why that happens is that subconsciously, you know what's going to happen next. Now, if you watch an action film again, of course, the second time, you already know what's going to happen. This operates in a very subconscious level in music. It's almost proof that what I'm talking about is true. Because maybe you don't know it, but it does powerfully affect our enjoyment. So I'm going to help you enjoy this song more by appreciating the insides more. That's the goal. Okay? Let's try it, and I'll walk you through it. One, two, three, four, two, three, four, five, six, and, okay, two, four, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12, repeat, one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12. One, two, three, four. Very predictable, right? Same thing, it's a square. Now, okay. Five, six, seven, eight. Watch out for the extra bar. Nine, 10, 11, 12. Did you see it? Right? And in fact, Paul filled that in, or whoever it was, filled that in with a screen because it needs something, but it delays it, right? It delays it for just enough. It's a tiny thing, but it's great. Oops. Here it is again. Five, six. So now we're back where we expect it, right? Nine, 10, 11, 12. Chorus. Three. Another verse. Just let on here. Outro. Two. Seven. So you notice that the same music is here and here, but this time it's 8 bars, and this time it's 6. Okay, so it's actually, this is what's called, musicians would call this an elided cadence. You don't learn that until like junior year as a music major, but the Beatles did it, okay? Another thing I want to point out is that not only are the lengths of the phrases or sections different, but actually it's hard to predict what's going to come next. In fact, if I didn't have this, and this actually, with my little mistakes I made, you still can't predict what's going to come next, right? So this is actually a great, that's why I did it, right? The idea is that if I didn't chart this out, you'll notice that sometimes there's 2 verses in a row. Sometimes there's 1. There's a bridge that's thrown in there, which we sort of expect. Then there's a chorus that comes back. So the roadmap is actually a little bit unpredictable, too. Again, in 2.5 minutes or so, there's a fair amount of unpredictability, and we haven't even talked about rhythm, harmony, and so many other sort of really very normal things to talk about when we talk about music. I'm just saying that our path through the song is sort of circuitous, and it basically keeps us from knowing what's going to come next and how long that's going to last. If you, any of you have had kids, you know this is, you can, you, this is a, this is how timeouts work, right? So you're gonna, for a 5-year-old, you're going to take a timeout, my 5-year-old will say, I'll say 10 inch. She goes, she'll argue with me. She'll say, no, 15. Because she sort of, maybe she was 4. Like, she has no concept of how long things last anyway, right? So I found myself haggling, and I realized that it doesn't really matter what I say. I'll say, fine, 15 if you'd like. It doesn't matter. I'm still going to go up there after a certain amount of time. But, you know, timeouts are rough because she doesn't know if she's ever getting out. You know, I mean, she will eventually, a couple hours, 3 or 4. But I mean, imagine if your concept of time is so screwed that you're never quite sure, like, when it's going to change, like, when this I'm going to get out of this boring room. Well, essentially, in a microcosmic way, in a tiny little way, that's what's happening in this song. So we don't know what's going to come next, really, and how long that's going to last. And on a subconscious level, I argue that that keeps us really attentive to the song. And it pulls us on a line all the way through until it's done. And just like a great action film, that's one of the things that makes a great song. Okay? So you can actually try this at home. And this is why this is fun. You go home, pick your favorite Beatles song, and do this. Count this. Figure out how many verses, how many choruses, if that's something you feel comfortable doing. And then count how long they last. And you might be surprised that you're going to end up with a diagram here that's somewhat similar, that's not cookie cutter, it's not too predictable. So I'm going to move on and talk about I Want to Hold Your Hand, which is really one of the perfect pop songs, really, ever. And we're not actually going to talk about how long each section is. Instead, we're going to talk about two other elements of musical structure that are very, very important. And also demonstrate this idea of music as a sort of a suspense thriller. So I would say that in the melody of I Want to Hold Your Hand does the exact same thing, if you follow me, that the form for Can't Buy Me Love does. Okay, the melody in I Want to Hold Your Hand creates a constant sense of suspense that pulls you along from moment to moment. And you never quite know what's going to happen. Now, we all know the melody well at this point, right? So we don't have the fresh experience of someone in 1962 or 1963, right? But I would argue that if you start to pay attention to that melody, you appreciate its genius, and maybe you start to understand why you've loved it for 50 years, perhaps. It still might delight and surprise you. So I want to play I Want to Hold Your Hand, in case you haven't heard it in a while. And I'm going to ask you to help me out here. Now, if any of you have brought a pencil or a pen, that's great, and you can play along at home or here. And I'm gonna ask you to do what's something we call I'm gonna ask you to diagram the melody, and that's very, very simple. It's just take your pen, and if you don't have a pen this week, next week, or I'll dock you a grade. Okay? Megan is taking attendance. When the melody goes up, you go up. So at the beginning, oh yeah, right? Do you see what I did? You see how the music sort of goes down? Oh yeah, tell you something, I think you'll understand. What's the direction of that melody? Can you hear that? Oh yeah, tell you something, I think you'll understand. Now what's next? Where does it go next? It starts up again, same exact thing, right? When I said something, and then of course, as we expect, it goes right back down, right? It follows the pattern, right? I want to hold your hand. Right? No! Exactly! My point exactly. So you'll notice that it starts, oh yeah, I'll tell you something that you'll understand. Then it starts the same way. And it's going to rhyme. Everyone knows it's a formulaic pop song, right? And when I say that something, I want to hold your hand! Right? I mean, it's the highest song, the highest note in the piece. So I'll play it for you, but look, this is what happens, right? Sorry, right? Right? You'll notice, and that's a surprise, but we do not see that coming. In fact, 50 years later, sometimes it's a surprise that you get that moment, right? So here's an example of a pattern that's set up, some kind of expectation. You think, this happens 3 or 4 more times, you're bored. Instead, the second time, boom, surprising moment, right? And now, so I'll play it for you, and then diagram with me, tell me what happens next, okay? And now, Don't we get another shot at it, right? But any thoughts about what happens next? Right, in fact, you'll notice it actually hangs out up here for a little while, and then it goes down nice and easy to the very bottom. Okay, and we get it again. In fact, it goes by so fast, I'll play from the top of the song again. Okay? Twice. Right? Happens twice. Now we're going to do the whole thing exact the same, right?
Let me be your man. And please say to me, you let me hold your hand. I let me hold your hand. I want to hold your hand.
So, you can see that in terms of melodic contour, whether when the music goes up or the melody goes up or down, is actually quite unpredictable, right? In fact, I would argue that first low note's surprising too. It should go, oh yeah, I'm sorry, oh yeah, tell you something, I think you'll understand. That's what it should go like, right? Mm-hmm. And if I wrote that, it would not be a hit. But instead, instead there's that little tiny wrinkle. Oh yeah, I tell you something, I think you'll understand. And in fact, that note is wrong. It's too low for the melody. And there's actually a new chord that's used at that moment too. That's harmony, another story, right? But the point is that even on a tiny, tiny level, there are these moments that keep you, it's like a tiny little detour, right? And then he starts, so that's a tiny one, and then he starts it again, and we're getting essentially a hierarchy, a nesting series of expectations that are thwarted. We get a little one here, and then a bigger one here. Right? Are you sort of with me? Again, a tiny moment of surprise, a bigger moment of surprise, right? So the next thing to do would be, how do you even have a bigger moment of surprise? Because you got to keep upping the ante, right? I mean, when I tell my student composers about how to write music like this, even without lyrics, I say, think of an action film. If you start with a motorcycle chase, well, the next chase is going to have to be a car. That's four wheels. The next chase has to be tanks, because that's treads. Then eventually you're going to have to go blimp. Well, blimp chases are not, we're not saying. But airplane, and then essentially fighter jet, and then spaceship. Right? You have to keep going, you have to up the ante to keep people's interest. Right? And again, in a tiny little microcosmic way, that's what happens here. A tiny surprise, a bigger surprise, and here's the next surprise. What happens after we hear the verse twice in this song? Do you remember? And when I asked you, right? There's a second piece of, in fact, there's a second, it's not really a bridge, it is sort of a bridge. But the point is that this whole thing becomes the new pattern. I don't care how interesting this verse is, the moment you get it twice, snoozers, right? So what does a songwriter have to do? Blimp, right? It's a whole new part of the song. Because if this song went verse 1, verse 2, verse 3, that's when you'd turn off the radio. It would. You never hear more than two verses in a row, even today, 50 years on, because three times is boring of anything, right? And so we're going to hear a verse again, but it's starting to get old, so then switch it up. That's the next level of suspense, okay? So this is a very abstract thing to talk about, but I know, maybe, are you following me here about how this works? I mean, it's such a
breakaway.
It's very abstract, but it's powerful. It's a substructure. You know, it's the skeleton to the song that makes it work and be a great song, you know, even if it's, you know, oh yeah, I tell you something, I think you'll understand. In fact, for the polka version, it's still, like, there are still things about that song that make it great, right? And I'm Polish, so I like a polka. Okay, let's go back and listen to the beginning, at least to that point. Try to follow that drama, okay? Detour, right? All right. Let me try that again.
I wanna hold your hand. Oh,
Now I know it's coming, right? Now I know it's coming. Right, so. See, that's not a detour anymore. I knew it was coming. I'm still here. Something else has to detour me now, right? Right? Oh, yeah! Different key, different melody, right? 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 Now I'm ready. I'm ready to go back to the beginning, because I like that first part, right? And now the return is so much more exciting, right? Because I missed it. Absence makes the heart grow fonder, right? 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 And now I'm happy. I tend to talk over music to narrate, like the bouncing ball. Okay, so if you didn't hear me, basically I'm just demonstrating that the more something happens, the less exciting it is, and the more it takes us to have a detour. And that happens in a Beethoven symphony, and it happens in a tiny little perfect pop song. All right? Now, I want to tell you about something else. Oh, yeah, I want to tell you. I'm going to tell you something I think you'll understand about the Beatles. And this is another example of an abstract musical element of this song that creates this powerful sense of drama and suspense. And that is something called harmonic rhythm. Now, you probably know the term rhythm. It's usually it's very hard to define, actually. I'm not going to go there. But we tend to think we know what rhythm is. And harmony, that's chords. Those are different. You know, you sit down, you practice playing your chords. I'm playing just chords, essentially, there, right? And then there's rhythm. Harmonic rhythm is those two things combined. It's the pace at which chords change. It's the rate of change of chords. So when someone says, do you like that song? What are the chords in it? C, F, G, A minor. That's one half, but what's really important is how fast those chords go by. Nobody talks about harmonic rhythm. And when I teach a songwriting class at Wheaton, I talk about this all the time because it's so important. And let me show you how it works. In your handout, you've got some musical notation. And you'll see that these are things called whole notes, these little eyeballs, right? You may recognize them. And they count, there are four counts, right? One, two, three, four. And when that happens, there's a measure line or a bar line, and then we have another bar. These notes represent how long a chord lasts. So the first chord in this song lasts for four beats. The next chord lasts four beats, right? The next chord, no matter what it is in this song, lasts four beats. You with me so far? I'm not really talking about what those chords are. I'm talking about how fast the chords change. It's weird to not listen for chords, but just it's again, very abstract, and you're following me very, very nicely. Look what happens here. One, two, three, four, five, for eight chords in a row, very, very predictable. Four beats long, okay? And of course, you might think that's pretty boring. And you know what? It is pretty boring, okay? But what happens in the ninth bar? Well, we start to have half notes, and half notes last half as long as a whole note. So the chords start to change twice as fast. Follow that, follow along with me. Again, these chords last one, two, three, four, one, two, three, happens eight times, and then at a certain point, the chords start to change twice as fast, only two beats. You see how that happens? If you have a sheet of paper? Oh, and here it is, actually, I wrote it down. That's right. So, and I will play this for you a few times so you can see how this works, but that's gonna create a sense of acceleration, like we were speeding up how fast we were walking. And let me show you how that works. Let's imagine I take a step for every time a chord changes. Oh yeah, one, two, three, four, something. I think you'll understand. And I say that something. I wanna hold your hand. Ready? I wanna hold your hand. I wanna hold your hand. I'm walking twice as fast. See what happens? I literally am walking twice as fast. I'm covering twice as much ground because my stride length isn't changing. And our experience of the music is like the song got twice as fast, okay? And again, it's, I think if you count, you'll follow it. Let me walk you through it. I'm literally going to walk you through it, okay? So from the beginning. Oops. Okay. So count four counts for each of those whole notes. Ready? break. One, three, four, one. A chord changes in every step. Okay? Ready? Chord, 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 chord. Stop. Happens again. Here it is.
Let me hold your hand. I wanna hold your hand.
Can you hear or see or feel that?
Yeah.
Now, Ringo's not playing drums any faster. No one's actually playing any faster. But since the chords go by faster, there's this sensation that the music speeds up, or I would say maybe it doesn't speed up, but intensifies, right? So harmonic rhythm, increasing harmonic rhythm, as we would say, is a way of making a part of a piece of music sound more important and exciting, okay? And the question would be, well, where in the music, or where in the lyrics, I should say, does that speeding up happen? On what lyric? Do you remember? Well, yeah, on the chorus, right? Which is the answer to the question. Remember, this is a song, oh yeah? I'll tell you something. I think you'll understand it. Okay, I'm about to tell you something. Hang on a sec. You just keep saying, right? You know, I'm going to tell you something. Now wait for it. Okay? I want to hold your hand. That's why I want to hold your hand. Right? It's very... Exactly. Yeah. Give me the hand. Exactly. Right? And so there's in the lyric, and this is not a Shakespearean tragedy here, okay? But the fact is that there is some suspense, right? Where there is... And the music moves slowly, right? It's plodding. It's sort of like, I'm creeping up to you. Like a little kid. Right? And then all of a sudden, right? But it's like, I mean, he grabs the hand and he pulls. And in the sense that then he answers the question and the music speeds up and there's an intensity. And guess what happens at the same time on the beginning of the chorus? Remember that melody? What happens in the melody at the beginning of the chorus? Sorry. It goes up. And this is how music works. All these things work together. So I would add to our diagram. If you do a harmonic rhythm, at this point, it's the highest note in the song. It's the most exciting, surprising note in the song. It's a lyrical answer to the question, and the harmonic rhythm increases. So at this moment, all these musical things come together to make this the most exciting part of the song. Again, the lyrics answer the question. The melody goes to its highest note, which is held. And the harmonic rhythm increases. So all these elements of musical structure combine at that moment to make that moment the peak, the most important and important moment, important and powerful moment. And that's really why, it's one of the reasons why this song is so great, because it's a unified whole. We can pick it apart. The melody itself is not what makes it great. The harmonic rhythm is by itself is not what makes it great. The lyrics by themselves are certainly not fantastic, but putting it all together creates this extraordinary drive to this moment, and then essentially a release, okay? Where and we can feel the music building as the suspense builds, and then there's the answer, okay? Which, let's say you're like a 13-year-old kid, I mean, this can be your entire world, whether the girl wants to hold your hand at the roller rink or not. I mean, and this is what this music was for, don't forget. Who this music was initially for. This is teeny bopper music, you know? I mean, no one foresaw what the Beatles were going to come up with in 1965, right? Remember, this is 1962 or maybe 63, I don't remember. And in an adolescent's life or a preteen's life, yeah, that's an extraordinary thing. That'll make your entire month if the girl holds your hand, right? So let's not downplay how important this is. And this song captures that, right? It captures that freshness and that excitement, that wonderful moment in which you first hold her hand at the roller skating rink. You know, and how does that happen? Well, it happens by a subtle interplay of these elements of musical structure that combine to make that moment wonderful. Let's play it. I don't want to talk over it. Let's listen to it one more time and see if you can really see how all these things happen. And the music goes down, right?
I wanna hold your hand.
and I might mention that, as in a lot of great songs, the B section or the bridge is really boring. Because why? What's that?
The big excitement is already over.
It's already over.
But it's coming back.
Yes, exactly. I mean, it's like when you have a great ice cream sundae is not chocolate ice cream, chocolate sauce, chocolate sprinkles, chocolate covered cherry, fried in chocolate, right? It's vanilla ice cream with just enough chocolate to keep it interesting, right? And a cherry and those little pineapple chunks, okay? Maybe. But the point is that you need, after a fantastic verse or memorable A section, if you will, often what comes next, has to be like this, that sorbet that they give you at fancy restaurants to get you ready for the next one, right? And if you don't have that, it's too chocolatey. And so the return to the verse is so exciting in this song, partially because the bridge is so predictable and boring. And when I'm happy inside, it's such a feeling that my love, I can't hide, I can't hide, I can't hide. Boom, and then we're back to where we started, right? Yeah, you know what I mean? And so he sets you up for that. Another example of how this song is a mini drama, and again, this would work if this song were in Swedish. In fact, many of you know the Beatles went to Hamburg a couple of times and really perfected their craft, and everybody heard the German version of the song?
Yeah.
Come give mir deine Hand? Right? Yeah, yeah. It's in German, right? So I would argue you don't need to know that it's about hand holding. It's not really about hand holding. Okay? But it's not about drugs either. It's about something else. But the point is that, I mean, there's elements of musical structure that make this powerful no matter what literal language you're using. And just to prove that, you may wonder why, if you have a handout, where there's a mention of Mozart here. Because Mozart was a big fan of Paul McCartney, and frankly ripped him off, and because I just want to prove to you that Mozart does this. And of course, I mean, the Beatles' background was interesting, and some of them had a lot of exposure to classical music, but they didn't study classical composition. So how did they know to do this? Because they were brilliant geniuses who could absorb these aspects of musical structure, which are sort of universal, at least within the Western tradition. So Mozart does this exact same thing in one of his most famous pieces. And when I say this thing, I mean the idea of harmonic rhythm speeding up as you get to the exciting part of a piece. Okay? So this is a diagram of the harmonic rhythm of a famous Mozart piece, which you'll recognize. And you'll notice what happens here is it goes whole notes, half notes, and he goes McCartney one better, quarter notes, and then eighth notes. So the chords start to change eventually 8 times as fast by the end. All right? Let me play a little snippet at the beginning of this. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3. Sorry. So it's 1. Hear the half notes. Change, 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 change. Ready? Change, 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 change. And so I'm not going to talk over it again. But again, you'll notice that that's why this drives. I'll walk it through. Twice as fast. Twice as fast again. Sorry, here there's N. 3, 4, 1. You get the picture, right? Okay. Mozart even throws in an extra bar, which is what confused me. So my point is that this is a fundamental aspect of musical structure that has this effect upon us, whether it's classical music or music that's very, very different. And if you're trying to build to a peak and make a certain moment of music exciting, this is one of the things you do, no matter what kind of music you're writing. And the Beatles demonstrate it, and so does Mozart, amazingly. So I don't have time to talk about "She Loves You," but if you do have a handout, I talk about two other things that we've actually already talked about. I would have, and maybe I will at some point later, talk about the melody of "She Loves You," the contour when it goes up and down, and again the harmonic rhythm, how fast the chords go by. And if you're following along at home, you need to add something to this to this chart, and if you're going to go home and try to count this out, where it says chorus, you need to tie together these two pairs of whole notes. Because what happens in She Loves You is that the harmonic rhythm slows down. The breaks get put on in the chorus. It's the exact opposite thing that happens in I Want to Hold Your Hand. So instead of chords going by every four beats, they go by every eight beats. And just because this may be a new concept for you, I'll just play that song once, and I'll count it through for you. And the experience of the song is very, very different when the breaks get put on. So let's count that through, and then we'll take some questions and comments.
God,
no, I'm sorry. Another great one. Not yet. When the verse happens. So ready? One. Chord. Now here it slows down. Ready? Can you sense that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. If no one else is home with you, you can even walk in your living room and try this. But I would argue that this actually is perfect for the lyrics, because think about it. You think you lost your love. You saw her yesterday. I saw her yesterday. You know, it's usually, there's two guys, who maybe guys, girls, talking. One guy's pretty anxious, you know, and so the music's going by kind of fast, right? I saw her yesterday, but you know, it's you she's thinking of, and she told me what to say, right? And then, then at that point, the intensity doesn't increase, does it? It actually decreases, because chill out, man. She loves you, right? And so the music slows down. She said she loves you. And you know that can't be bad. Yeah. Right? And so, the drama of the lyrics, the preteen drama of the lyrics, is the opposite of I Want to Hold Your Hand, right? I mean, they both actually sort of build up tension, but one of them releases them so gently. It's okay, relax. And so the harmonic rhythm slows down, and our experience of the song is much more relaxed during the chorus, as opposed to in that little, the refrain, and I want to hold your hand. So just a tiny taste about how a brilliantly composed song is this unity between lyrics and musical structure, right? Sense that we're picking apart and parsing these little songs, but I'm hopefully explaining a little bit about why they work. And not just because the musical structure by itself is interesting, not because the lyrics are profound, because they're usually not, but man, the combination is perfect. And if you read the little article in the Ledger, I make this claim that the Beatles wrote some perfect pop songs. And my claim is that everything is there that needs to be there, and there's nothing there that doesn't need to be there, like a gem. It's pure and it's perfect. And I think that's one definition of perfection. And I would argue that some of these songs are like that, because they do exactly what they need to do in the exact right way. And it's so rich and compelling and so perfectly put together that you never get tired of looking at that ring on your finger, right? As long as it's big enough, right? Just like you never get tired of listening to or looking at a beautiful face or listening to a song that's just perfectly well put together. How the Beatles did that? God came down and touched them, you know? who knows why, but they did, and we are very, very lucky. Now, what's fascinating is what we're going to talk about next week, which is how did the Beatles, where do they go from here? Like, they mastered writing the 2 or 3 minute pop song for a certain audience. All it took was some drugs. and some growing up, right? And they were able to write songs that were so different in their middle psychedelic period, yet, as we will see, manifest many of the same types of sort of perfection. But this is almost like the Beatles' second period is sort of, if we just sort of injected steroids into these songs, or not just steroids, right? But this is the bedrock, the foundation of the Beatles' music. And if you can write a 2 minute pop song, I mean, you can write a symphony, because you know how music is put together, right? In fact, I've written one symphony, and there's a part of it that I actually rip off from the Beatles, but you would never tell, because I don't rip off a melody. I actually rip off one of these ideas, right? And that's like the best part of the symphony. You know, because you know what? They got it. They nailed it. And it's like, again, it's they're some of these are, I would consider, you know, quote unquote perfect, if you could put perfection in